Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 24 of Limited Time Only. I'm your host, just like every week, or in this case, like, it's been like 3 weeks.
It has been a while.
And I'm joined by Drew Walden. What's up, Drew?
Oh, nothing much. Just trying to play a little bit of Magic, so.
So for those who don't know, I have been super busy, like, with tons of stuff. Like, also, we had Super Bowl week and, like, all kinds of stuff has come up. And so I, unfortunately, have been neglecting to get on Drew and doing this podcast, and that's my fault. But we are back. We won't be skipping weeks anymore in the near future. I am in contact with getting I'm trying to find, actually, a couple sponsorships. We'll probably be posting in some new places coming up soon, and that's exciting. But we are back, and we're excited to talk about Oath Commons. We usually would do this like before this set comes out in like pre-release time, but since we kind of were behind, we're going to do it now. And we also get to talk about like kind of what we've learned from the set, and I still have my biggest mover and like things like that. But let's get started with pick two. So every week we talk about, picks one and two, or picks two and three in a pack after our first pick. But I actually find this pack so interesting that we're going to do a pack one, pick one scenario with it too. So our options for pack one, pick one, so it's just basically a crack a pack, is comparative analysis, bone saw, binds of the recluse. That's the first card that I'm even willing to think about first picking, by the way, Drew, is binds of the recluse. But I would still be unhappy to pick it here.
Yeah, not happy to pick a binds of the recluse first pick.
Yeah, but it's so much better than the other two cards. Untamed hunger, crumbling vestige. I would never take an Untamed Hunger ever, and Crumbling Vestige has been dropping more and more throughout my drafts. I think it's just too easy to get, like, a holdout settlement.
Yeah, I think Crumbling Vestige is... It might even be worse than Wastes.
That's how I think. I know people say that it's, like, the good version of Wastes, and I don't think that's true. I actually don't like Crumbling Vestige, because I think that if you want colorless lands in your deck, it's because you want your colorless mana, like, on time.
Yeah, you want it, because a lot of times what ends up happening is your colorless lands are a splash, so then you're like, okay, I really need to top deck my colorless mana, and you top deck a Crumbling Vestige, and you're like, ugh. So, and Waste has the added benefit of being searchable by, you know, effects that search for basic lands.
Next up we have Alpha Protector, that's the 1/4 ally soldier. That card has been way better than I thought it would be, just to, on a note. Then we have a Mighty Leap, we have Akum Flameseeker, Holdout Settlement, and then we get to the interesting part of the pack. Next up we have Zada's Commando. This is a card that I have really high.
Yeah, Zada's Commando is, very good. I'm still surprised it's a common.
That's my thought.
It feels like an uncommon to me, yeah. But yeah, a 2-power First Striker for 2 mana is, like a first rate card, and then the fact that it has an additional ability that
he's commando and, dude he's
yeah
no
the additional ability that's relevant in the late game is pretty nice too.
Yeah, I would not be ashamed to take a Zados Commando first pick at all.
Nope.
The pack gets interesting. We have Immolating Glare, that's 1 and a white for an instant, destroy target attacking creature. Is that willing to push you out of Zados Commando range?
Yeah, I mean, I would take Immolating Glare over Commando pretty easily.
So I don't want to be in white right now because I think there's fighting over white and black cards. I would still I currently in my drafts, I'm almost always drafting red because people don't fight over it. So red, I would actually still take the commando. I do think Immolating Glare is better. I think that it's almost unconditional removal in this format, unless you're playing against obviously like the cohort decks. But even those decks, like, they're going to attack you some number of the time. I don't know. I do like Immolating Glare a lot, but I think I would still take Commando. Rune in Their Wake is not something we're interested in, but Cyclone Sire is something that you might be interested in. Probably not over Glare or Commando, though.
No, I would still take Immolating Glare over both of those cards.
Yeah. Well, the rare is Oath of Chandra, though. So that card is 1 and a red for a legendary enchantment. When it enters the battlefield, do 3 damage to target creature and opponent controls. And then you can do, and then if you play a Planeswalker, it does other things.
Basically, it's just Volcanic Hammer.
Yeah.
The option to hit the face. So, yeah, I think it's between Oath of Chandra and Immolating Glare.
I would take Oath of Chandra. I do not want to be in white right now on Moto specifically, but I do think Immolating Glare is still really good.
Yeah, I think I'd take Glare over Oath, just because it's more powerful than Oath is. And yeah, I'm not opposed to taking a white card first pick. Obviously, you know, you have to see what's happening when you're getting passed. But
I think they're really close to each other, and so my preference would lead me to take the Oath. But I can definitely see the argument for Glare.
Yeah, I mean, and if you end up in a white deck, I mean, I think you're gonna be pretty happy having an Immolating Glare in your deck, so.
Sure. So, pick two, we have Kozilek's Pathfinder. That's the 6-mana 5/5 with the activated ability. The target creature can't block it. Sweep Away, this is a card that some people are down on. I'm not yet. It's return target creature to its owner's hand at instant speed. If that creature is attacking, put it on top of their library. I'm a pretty big fan of this card.
Yeah, Sweep Away is actually a lot better than I had originally thought it was. Like, on paper, I looked at Sweep Away, and I thought, yeah, it's okay. And then, kind of the more I played, I was like, okay, yeah, Sweep Away is pretty good.
Yeah, I know that others are down on it. They actually think it's not as good as they thought, but they might have been too high on the card to start with. Next up, we have the Abstruse Interference. I'm not interested in that. Bonesaw, not interested in that. Umara Entangler has been pretty good for me, but I'm not taking that this early. I could wheel that, no problem. Dazzling Reflection, not interested. Spark Mage's Gambit, not interested. Warden of Geometries, where are you out on this card?
It's... Eh.
Yeah, I mean, even like playing it.
Yeah, I mean, if you need a certain amount of colorless sources, or if you're just hurting for creatures, then it's a fine-ish role player, and by fine-ish, I mean 22nd or 23rd card. So, yeah, I mean, I'll play Warden of Geometries, but it's not, like, the most exciting card.
I think that I'm unhappy if there's a Warden of Geometries in my deck.
Yeah, I don't know if I'm unhappy, but I'm just kind of like, if I have to play it, then I'll play it, so.
Shoulder to Shoulder is next. This card's way better than I thought it was.
Yeah, I think I was kind of high-ish on Shoulder to Shoulder even when the set very first came out. Just, you know, Shades of Travel preparations that draws a card. So
sure.
I was like, man, I bet this card's pretty good. I even took it fairly high in the first draft I did with the set. Ended up not playing it because I had so many playables that I just didn't have room. Like, when am I going to cut Grip of Desolation or Oblivion Strike? Like, nah. But sure. Yeah, I think in general I like the card a lot.
Eldrazi Aggressor is next. That's the 2/3 that has haste if you control another colorless creature for red and 2. Weapons Trainer, not interested in that. And then Thought Harvester, 1 blue and 3 for a 2/4. Devoid Flying, whenever you cast a colorless spell, the opponent exiles the top card of their library, and then we have Hissing Quagmire. So for me, this is between Sweep Away and Thought Harvester, I think. I think that they're both better than Shoulder to Shoulder.
Yeah, I agree. The blue cards, I think, are just pretty much the standout cards in the pack. So either way, I think you're just taking a blue card here. The question is which blue card you want to take. At this point, I think I want to go with Sweep Away. I think the card is, like I said, is much better than I expected. And it's surprisingly good when people are putting a bunch of counters on creatures, which happens a lot in this set, as well as it's pretty reasonable versus like Awaken cards. So yeah, I definitely like Sweep Away, I think. So I would take Sweep Away here. I could definitely see the argument for taking Thought Harvester.
I would also take Sweep Away. I like, so as I would have picked Oath of Chandra, I like getting my cheaper spells first in the blue-red deck. Or cheapish spells, I guess. Sweep Away is cheap enough that you can play the 4-drop that you can search for 2 with it. What is the 3/2 menace guy? You know what I'm talking about, right?
Let's see. Oh, the surge guy. Sure.
Yeah. I think Goblin
Free Runner.
Free Runner. Yeah.
Yep.
So I would take I would take sweep away also, so that my deck already starts to have interactive spells pretty early. So pick three. It sounds like we're both on sweep away, so.
Yep.
We have Undo War Cleric. This card's way better than I thought it was. I still don't know that I want it this early, but I know people think this is, like, the best common in the set. I believe that was said on Pro Tour coverage.
Who said it was the best common in the set?
I think the MTG Cardmint guys did.
I mean, it's a very good common, but I don't think it's as good as Oblivion Strike.
Yeah, I don't either, but... Reality Hemorrhage is next. I'm actually a huge fan of this card. People have been dogging on this card, saying, like, oh, two damage isn't enough in this set, and I'm like, what are you talking about? It kills tons of things, and then you can surge.
Yeah, it's fine. It's a shock. I mean, shocks are always, like...
Man, if this card was shock, if this card was shock, it would be, like, the best card in the set.
I don't think that's true. I mean,
that's how I feel.
I mean, I can definitely see that with, like, the surge thing going on and everything, but when I say a shock, I just mean it's just a cheap two damage.
Right. I'm just kidding. Little hyperbole there. Hold on.
Yeah.
It wouldn't actually be the best. It would probably be the best red common, though. I think it would be better than Boulder Salvo.
No, I still think Boulder Salvo would be better.
You think so?
Yeah. I mean, definitely it would definitely be quite a bit better than what it is. But the thing is, shock effects they're always dependent on the format they're in.
Right.
You know, in way back in, like, Onslaught Block, shock might as well just have said destroy target creature.
Sure.
Basically, that's what it was. You killed almost anything. Even, like, if you had a shock in, say, Khanzatar Kir, because, again, morphs, just they die to it.
Right.
In this set, there's still quite a few creatures that die to it. You know, a lot of the red creatures die to it. Quite a few of the white creatures die to it. But there's quite a few creatures that just completely dodge it. So,
sure.
It's a card you're going to take middling pick. You're going to put it in your deck. You're not going to be unhappy about having it in your deck. But it's not like, oh, yeah, I ended up with three reality hemorrhages in my deck.
Oh, wow. I disagree. I love reality hemorrhage. I think that it kills enough things... that, like, it stunts your opponent's support, and it, like, enables your surge. I actually really like the card.
Yeah, I just remember, like, in my pre-release deck, I had two, and I was playing both of them. But I ended up, you know, I played versus the deck, and I boarded both of them out. Because I'm just like, this literally doesn't kill anything in his deck, so.
Well, next up we have Goblin Free Runner. This is three and a red for a 3/2. It's got Goblin Warrior Ally as a creature type. It's got Surge for two, and it has Menace. This is actually becoming a hard pick for me between those two cards already.
Yeah, I mean, I think I still take Hemorrhage because removal is removal. It kills a lot of flyers too, and flyers are pretty important in this format.
Yeah.
But Free Runner, I think, is much better than I had originally thought when I looked at the card, so.
Yeah, even since I made the show notes, Free Runner has gone up for me. Because we'll be talking about our comments. I also am on Hemorrhage still, but I think it's much closer than I had initially thought. Untamed Hunger, we're still not into. Cultivator Drone, though, is a 3-mana 2/3 with Devoid, and then you can tap it to add a colorless to spend this mana only to cast colorless spell. Spend this mana only to cast a colorless spell. Activate an ability of a colorless permanent, or pay a cost that contains colorless.
Yeah, I like Cultivator Drone a lot. It's a body you would play in Limited. You know, a 2/3 for three.
It's a Minotaur.
Granted, not exciting, but
it's a Minotaur in blue, though, right? Like,
yeah, I mean, you're not like, ooh, I'm got a 2/3 for three, but you're like, all right, I'll play this. And then on top of that, the fact that it lets you cast colorless spells is pretty nice. It can even ramp. You know, you could play like a 5-drop that's colorless on turn 4. So, it's a pretty exciting play. So yeah, I like Cultivator Drone a decent amount. I like it. I think better than the red cards. So that have been listed so far.
It's hard for me. I think that I would still take Hemorrhage, but I like Cultivator Drone a lot. Expedite is next. It's one red for an instant. Target creature gains haste until end of turn. Draw a card. Where are you at, man? Is this what you want to do in your search deck?
I mean, if I have, I don't, like, if I have a bunch of surge cards, then sure, I'll take this, but it's not a third pick card. It's definitely like a, all right, got five cards left in the pack. I'm taking this expedite to,
I feel the exact same way,
to fill my deck out. And I mean, if you end up with a really sweet surge deck, like surge slash prowess deck, it could be very powerful for sure. But I mean, you should be able to pick these up late anyways, because conventional decks don't necessarily.
Really nobody else wants it, so you don't have to pick it this high.
Yeah.
Next we have Kozilek's Translator. He's got a rainbow behind him, but he's 5 mana for a 3/5 to void. Pay 1 life to add a color to manage your mana pool. People love this card, man.
Yeah, and he's actually a little bit worse. Like when the set was first spoiled, I looked at it and I just thought, oh, this was, you know, one of the best black cards or whatever. And then as I've played the set and stuff, I'm just like nowhere near as impressed with the card. I think
I thought it was bad, and now think it's okay.
Yeah. So I mean, it's a decentish body. It's a good blocker. It's not a great attacker, surprisingly enough.
I feel like it's super like. Like, there's certain draft styles, right? Like, you have LSV drafters, and then you have drafters like Kenji. Kenji really likes turning guys sideways, right? And LSV really likes playing 7 drops. And this is a card that I think LSV would like a lot more than someone like Kenji, and I am closer to the Kenji scale than I am to the LSV scale.
Yeah, I would say even like 5 years ago, I definitely was a much more aggressive limited player. I think I've kind of rounded myself out a little bit more, where sure. I'm willing to try and recognize the ability to play a variety of strategies in limited.
Sure.
But yeah, definitely like my tendency is, I think even when I'm playing controlling decks, is to try and find avenues to attack when I can. And Kozilek's Translator just is not a good attacking card. Great blocking card. It ramps you into really expensive cards too.
Yeah.
But outside of that, it's just kind of, and all the things I'm saying about the card, I still think it's a pretty good black card.
Yeah.
I just don't think it's as good as like Cultivator Drone or even Reality Hemorrhage. Probably not.
Yeah. I don't think I would take it over either of the red cards we talked about or Cultivator Drone. I do think it's playable. And I think that I went from thinking the card was bad to, like, I am willing to play this card and not actually be that upset about having it in my deck. Actually, I don't think I'd be upset about having it in my deck. I think that, like, the decks that want it are going to want it. I just currently am – I mean, my two cards are Earth of Chandra and Sleepway, and your two cards are Immolating Glare and Sweeper. Like, there's no way you're taking this card.
No.
At this point in the pack. Brute Strength is next. It's an instant that gives a creature +3/+1 and trample until end of turn. I don't know how I feel about this card.
It's better than I originally thought. I didn't think it was that great because I was like, it can be hard for you for your creature to win combat. But the fact that you can, I think in the early game, your creature will generally win combat enough of the time with the extra toughness.
It will.
And then in the late game, you can just like, you know, completely trample over like a chump blocker or something and kill your opponent with it.
The problem that I have with it is it's like, it feels like a bad Titan Strength and a bad Sure Strike.
Yeah, it's, I'm pretty sure it's worse than Sure Strike, generally speaking, but the trample is surprisingly relevant. I've heard quite a few horror stories of people thinking they were completely safe and then all of a sudden taking like an extra, you know, 6 damage or whatever from a Brute Strength because their creature that was getting blocked, you know, was doing a ton of extra damage to them.
Sure. I can see that. Kozilek's Pathfinder is next. I'm not really interested in this card at this point. It's fine. I don't want to take it this early. This is like a very late pick that sometimes will make it into my deck.
Yeah, Pathfinder is better than I had originally thought. Which is kind of funny because you think, oh, 5/5 for 6, not super exciting, especially considering when you compare it to a card like Ruin Processor, which is much bigger for its stats and gives you a really powerful effect when it comes into play. But it's actually played out, I think, a lot better than I thought it would. If you have one or two colorless sources, it becomes very difficult for your opponent to profitably profitably block it. But yeah, I'm not going to be taking it over like a card like Cultivated Drone.
All right. Next up we have Slaughter Drone. It's 1B1 for a 2/2. It's an Eldrazi drone. It's devoid. And you can pay a colorless to give it Death Touch.
I think this card's fine. It's, yeah, I'm not taking it, but like, you know, it's a bear that can also maybe hopefully trade with something giant in the late game, so.
Yeah, I've been moderately impressed with this against me. I have yet to play the card, but I have been like, oh wow, that was better than I thought it was going to be, but it's definitely not something that I'm taking over Reality Hemorrhage, Cultivator Drone, or Goblin Freerunner at this point.
Yep.
Next up we have Unity of Purpose. It's 3 and a blue. This card might be better as a red card. support 2 untapped creatures you control with 1/1 counters on them. I've heard people say that this is like a card you should never pass all the way down to not playable. What do you think?
I'm closer to the not playable side.
I have not been impressed.
Yeah, it's fine. I would probably play it in a deck, but yeah, I have no qualms about shipping this card.
I'm not taking this here. The next card we have is a card that also has, I thought is great, and I still think is great, and some people have a very differing opinion than me, and that's Allied Reinforcements. It's a white and 3 for a sorcery. Put two white knight ally creature tokens onto the battlefield.
Yeah, I mean, I like this card a lot.
I also like this card a lot.
Yeah, I mean, it gives you 4 power and 4 toughness for 4 mana, split up over 2 bodies. It's very powerful in the ally deck, you know, giving you two creatures to cohort with. When you have multiple cohort activations happening, it can definitely feel like the game's starting to slip out of control. So, yeah, I like this card a lot.
So what are you taking?
I would probably take Allied Reinforcements. I mean, I've already got a good white card with Immolating Glare. I've got a sweep away, you know, not married to the cards, but I think Allied Reinforcements is pretty easily for me going to be the pick out of these cards.
Yeah, I can see if you picked Immolating Glare first pick, taking the Allied Reinforcements. That's what I would do. With my first pick being Chandra, I want to play my removal, and I want to get removal, and I want it to be cheap. And so I would take Reality Hemorrhage. So... But that was very interesting. We are not at the same point in this draft format. That's great. That's a good thing. People think that that's a bad thing, but I think that means that the format is interesting.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, there's draft formats where things are just clearly so much better than other things that you're like, all right, obviously I take this. And I like draft formats where a card like Reality Hemorrhage is not as good as it looks on paper, and other cards are better than they look on paper. So I like this draft format. I think there's a lot of things going on, so.
All right. Well, let's talk about what's moved the most. For me, dude, Zabo's Commando, like, went from, like, top 5 to, like, one of the best commons for me. Like, currently, like, my favorite draft archetype is green-red. I think that you don't have to fight over anything when you're in that on Modo right now. While people are trying to figure out the format, they like drafting like the deck that they're told is the best deck. So whether it's green, white, black, or white, you know, white, you know what, tons of different white decks. Or if it's you know, some people really like black blue as well. And so for me, like, I just want to draft Saddleback Legax, and the best card to draft with that is, in my opinion, Zato's Commando. Holy crap.
Yeah, I mean, that. Obviously, counters are very powerful on first striking creatures. So, yeah, Zato's Commando has definitely impressed. Like I said, when I originally saw the card, I swear it was an uncommon. I definitely thought it was pretty strong. I mean, like I said, a 2-power first striker for 2 mana is very good, a very good rate anyways. And then it has gotten a little bit better, I think, over time. I liked the card a lot initially anyways, so I don't think it's moved quite as much for me.
I mean, I thought the card was good. I mean, it's a 2-power first striker, right? But, like, I underrated support a lot. Like, a ton. And it's funny because, like, we were talking about this on Constructed Criticism yesterday, that doing set reviews and things like that, they put you in a place where you have to evaluate what resources you find important in new ways. Because everything in Magic is a different resource. So, for me, I have to evaluate the resource of power and toughness onto creatures that are already on the battlefield instead of a new wait. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. So that's very different for me. Like, I remember drafting Travel Preparations and being like, oh, this card's great, but yet when I saw these new cards, it just didn't hit me.
Yeah, I mean, support was something that I thought was going to be pretty good from the get-go, like I said, because of my experience with Travel Preparations. Like, I remember thinking, I actually thought Expedition Raptor would be a pretty good card, and I still think it is. I still think Expedition Raptor is a pretty powerful card, because, you know, if you think about it, you're like, well, it's, you know, four points of power and toughness for 5 mana, and you get a flying body out of it. So, I mean, that's pretty good at the common level. So I definitely like support a lot when I first saw the set. And then obviously there's quite a few support cards running around at the common slot, at the uncommon slot that are, you know, have a pretty big impact on the game. And obviously when you can put counters on creatures with abilities like First Strike or Flying, they tend to be much more powerful than on, like, vanilla creatures.
Right. Yeah. I don't know. Like, you would think that all the time that I've played Magic and all the matches of Magic that I've won and lost to things would lead me to the conclusion that, like, why is it weird, Spencer, to you, before you even drop the set, to see that Zardoz Commando plus Saddleback Lagak is, like, insane? And it's it's just this challenge of, like, putting things together beforehand. And I didn't think those cards were bad. Like, to the contrary, I thought these cards are great. But and then my other biggest mover is actually Saddleback Lagak. It is I tweeted it out that it reminds me of playing with Bloodbraid Elf.
Yeah, I don't even think it's quite on that level, even in limited. But I mean, definitely very. Very powerful limited feature.
Yeah, I think that, like, it's a very, very, very poor... It's, like, a very poor man's Blood Red Elf, but it does give me those feels of, like, slightly a bit of haste plus another thing, and I don't know, man. It just feels good. I love Saddleback Lagak.
Yeah, I mean, Saddleback Lagak is a card that definitely went up a lot for me. It was actually one of the support cards I was the least impressed with, because...
Before playing, right?
Right, exactly. Because, you know, you have, like, if you asked me, like, okay, so you're going to play a support card. Your options are to play with a flying creature as a support card, a spell that draws you a card, or a vanilla one toughness creature. Like, I mean, on the face of it, faced with those options... A flying creature.
Oh yeah, I would have taken Raptor every time.
Yeah, it sounds much better than a vanilla creature, especially a vanilla creature with one toughness, because one toughness means it can be blocked by anything. Like, anything blocks Saddleback Lagak and trades with it. The thing I didn't realize and didn't think about is that, well, in limited, sometimes you just have bodies, right? Sometimes, like, you know, your opponent has a 2/2 or 2/3, and then another 3/3, and you have a 3/1, and you don't really care if your 3/1 trades with one of those. Or it's also a good blocker. I mean, blocking happens a ton in limited. Creatures are constantly brawling. Saddleback Lagak blocks a ton of creatures, you know, at the 4 slot. So that card actually moved up quite a bit. The other card that I didn't realize how good it was when the set first came out was Vampire Envoy.
That was kind of
a big mover for me. When I first saw Vampire Envoy, I was like, all right, this is kind of like a black filler card. You know what I mean? Like, all right, it's got some abilities. It's a 1/4 for 3, so it blocks. It's got flying, so it can plink in there. I guess it gains life when it, sure, whatever, you know, like, I wasn't, like, that blown away by it, but the more I've played the set, the more Vampire Envoy has just, like, been this kind of, you know, he's, I don't know sports terminology at all, but he's, like, he's like a forward in basketball, right? You know, like, he's not your guard making all these flashy plays or whatever, but he's the guy that's just like, all right, I'm here. I'm the guy you always want to start. You know, I'm going to be, you know, making the game go in a better route. He's great with cohort. You know, obviously, hey, I tap this guy, I gain some life. He's a great blocker. You know, even we've been talking about support. He's not a terrible card to support on either. Get your flyer a little bit more power and toughness. So, yeah, Vampire Envoy has gone up a lot for me.
Yeah, it's actually one of the reasons that I love McKinney Aeronaut. Like I already love 1/3s in Limited that have flying. Like, I actually think those cards are great for 2 mana. I think that's just a good Magic card. And, like, in this set, like, I've gotten McKinney Aeronaut's, like, 11th pick, and I'm like, what is happening? So Vampire Envoy, first of all, is probably one of the better black creatures you could support on, and not for multiple reasons. One, because, like, it's already a good blocker, and making it a 2/5 makes it a great blocker, and it also makes it a good attacker. Like, that trades with it doesn't trade with anything in there, and it kills most things that they would block with. And, like, its synergy with so many of the cohort cards is just too good.
Yep, yeah. Vampire Envoy has been awesome. I mean, that was kind of obvious, I think, like, you know, the first week of the set being out or whatever. But it was not a card when the set initially came out that I was looking at going like, oh, yeah, Vampire Envoy. It was just kind of like, all right, there's a middling black creature or whatever. And it's been very, very good.
All right. Well, let's get into... Let's get into the comments and let's talk about, like, where we're at right now today. And so the first thing that I want to talk about is we're going to go in Wooburg order and we're going to talk about white. And I think that no questions asked, Isolation Zone, we're both going to have a number one.
Yeah. 4-mana Oblivion Ring, still pretty powerful at common. So
yeah, and it's not even Oblivion Ring.
No, it's much worse than Oblivion Ring, but still very, 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 very good.
Yeah, surprisingly, if Wizards gives us removal, we will play it in any form.
Yeah, especially just straight-up unconditional removal. So.
Yeah, which is sad. It means that we're less likely to get Oblivion Rings in the future.
Oh, yeah, I don't think we'll ever see... We definitely will never see Oblivion Ring at Common ever again.
Yeah, but it also makes you wonder, like, will we ever get Banishing Light again? Like, is that a card that we'll ever see at Uncommon?
Yeah, I think so. Because I think Banishing Light is right at, I think Banishing Light's at a good power level for Uncommon, right? Like, it's a very good removal spell, but it's not, like, game-breaking, and obviously I think it's at the right power level for Constructed.
I wonder if they want to save that kind of removal for, like, Detention Sphere level, though. Like, I wonder if they want to make interesting Detention Sphere-type effects.
Possibly, but I mean, you know, obviously, as sets, you know, come and go, right? Like, you can be like, all right, so this set we're gonna have a Banishing Light, and then 2 or 3 sets later, when, or however many sets it is now, I don't know what it is, when Banishing Light rotates out, then you can maybe have, like, an interesting Oblivion Ring type of card or whatever. So
yeah, I wonder if the, when I think of cards like Isolation Zone, I'm like, you know, what is stopping Wizards from printing this card at instant speed? Like, giving this card flash, like, but then, first of all, it becomes an uncommon, right? Like, that's, so, but it is interesting to me, like, the design space that Isolation Zone and Oblivion Strike occupy, and I think that Wizards has discovered something that, we don't give them enough credit all the time. I say this on Constructed Criticism, I say this here, we do not give Wizards of the Coast enough credit, we don't give R&D enough credit. They know that Isolation Zone is going to be good, and that's why they can print it at this mana cost. When Drew and I look back on Limited, and we think of, like, playing with Lightning Bolt, Doomblade at Common, like, that's another world. Like, this is a different world that we lived in, and we are still happy. and not only happy, like very happy to take an isolation zone.
Yeah. I mean, even in sets with Doomblade and Lightning Bolt at common, I would still be pretty happy playing Isolation Zone in those sets.
I think we took for granted Lightning Bolt. Like, I think I took Shock for granted, in all honesty. I think that like things like Wild Slash are just, like, they're an uncommon for a reason. And I'm quite happy with Isolation Zone. I think it's the second best common in the set.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
So, I think we also both have our number two white common the same, right? Undo War Cleric.
Yeah, Undo War Cleric, is another card that really surprised me with how powerful it was. I mean, cause you look at Undo War Cleric and you think to yourself, all right, it's a Grizzly Bear, right? Like, you know, I'm not unhappy to play a Grizzly Bear, but I'm not jumping for joy to play it. And then you kind of slowly realize just how powerful that cohort ability is on when it's tacked onto a Grizzly Bear.
Yeah, I think that I've gained over 100 life already with 100 War Clerics.
I've not gained that much, but I was playing.
I gained 36 life in one match with one.
That's pretty absurd. I was playing a game last week, and my opponent had two Undo War Clerics out, and I'm just like, I can't, I wasn't losing, but I'm like, I'm not gaining any ground here. Like, it was miserable.
Yeah, it's interesting. First of all, I find it interesting how many, I think that this is something that I didn't realize going into the set, the number of allies. Like, there's so many allies.
Yep.
Like, you think, oh, man, it's going to be like, I have to tap two creatures, but it's like, I just have these things lying around. Like, they're everywhere.
Yeah, there's a ton of allies. And most of the allies you'd be happy playing even if they didn't have the creature type ally.
Yeah, I actually had a really hard time with my number three slot for common right now. And you actually have one of the reasons at your number three slot that it was so hard for me. Why don't you talk about your number three, and then I'll talk about why it was so hard for me.
Yeah, so my third is Core Skyclimber. It's just a 3-2 for three is a decent body, not the most exciting thing. But then the fact that you can jump it, you know, pay one and a white to give it flying until end of turn, I think is pretty good. Flying is a lot better in this format. I mean, flying is always a great evergreen ability. The fact that your creature has evasion and your opponents can't block is obviously very powerful. But I think especially even more in this set, board stalls happen a lot, and the ability to punch through in the air I think is very good. And so having a card that fits well on the curve, that can attack aggressively early, and then in the late game close out a game for you, I think is pretty good.
So I completely agree with everything you just said. There are 13 white commons. How many of them do you think you would be unhappy to play in your deck, Drew? I could probably tell you.
I mean, I've cited it in Dazzling Reflection. I don't think I would main deck the card.
So Dazzling Reflection is one of the ones that I have that you would be unhappy to play. Do you want to know how many I have total?
I'm going to guess two.
There are two white commons total that you would be unhappy to play.
Do I win a prize?
Yeah, I think that it's Dazzling Reflection, and what is the other one that I had? Maybe it's one. I thought I had, is that an uncommon? Oh, I apologize. Iona's Blessing is an uncommon.
Yeah, I mean, I, like, my...
White is super deep at common.
Yeah, I mean, they're all kind of, to me, they're all kind of like, again, it feels like the thing with Battle for Zendikar, where none of them, like, really jump. You're like, okay, these are all, like, just whatever creatures, but they're creatures you would play in your deck, so.
Yeah, like, when I think, Searing Light is one that I know some people are on the fence about, but it's one that I think you should play.
Yeah, I mean, I like having one Searing Light. I definitely think they start to get worse the more you have.
So. And this is why the third slot was so hard for me. So in the third slot, my choices were between Shoulder to Shoulder, Core Skyclimber, and Core Scythemaster, I think is actually super underrated. Man, I, to this moment, I literally have shoulder to shirtle written down, and I still don't know if I'm, like, even close to right. Because I think that those three cards are all really close to each other.
Yeah, I really like Scythe Master a lot, too.
Scythe Master is my favorite of the cards, but I think that Shoulder to Shoulder and Skyclimber are better.
Yeah, I think Skyclimber, I still think Skyclimber is better than Scythe Master, but I definitely think Scythe Master is a very powerful attacker. And Shoulder to Shoulder, I think, can be very, very, very powerful, and then other times it can be kind of, you know, mediocre or whatever, so.
Sure. I'm going to stick with Shoulder to Shoulder right now, because I think that it, like, enables something that is great. But I could see Skyclimber or Scythe Master, like, taking that number three spot from it. I also am interested in your opinion on Spawnbinder Mage. Where do you have this? Is this something you want?
So Spawnbinder Mage is kind of it's still kind of a weird card for me. The stats aren't great. It's a 2/4 for 4. I mean, it's not unreasonable for its cost, but I mean, you look at cards like Pillarfield Ox, you know, from older limited sets that just end up being chaff, right? Like, they end up being last picks and nobody ever plays them. So it has those stats. It's an ally, which is obviously great for cohort, and it has a cohort ability itself for tapping creatures, but the issue is you end up having to use two creatures to tap one of their creatures, which I think is good at a board stall. It's bad if you're racing, usually, right? Like, if they have three creatures out and you have three creatures out and they are actively attacking you, you don't want to be using two of your creatures to tap one of their creatures.
Right. Because unlike other cohort abilities, you can't use this one after blocks.
Yeah. It's good versus flyers. That's another thing to note, right? Like, if you're in a board stall situation, your opponent's like, well, I can't attack my ground creatures. Even when you tap two of your creatures, you can be like, all right, I'm going to lock your flyer down. So I think Spawnbinder Mage is – I definitely think you want at least one in your ally deck, because the nature of the ally deck is you will be in board stalls, and you want the board to be stalled out and clogged up and all that kind of stuff, because you're going to hopefully win with your cohort abilities.
Right.
And so you want to be able to lock down a creature that can threaten to kill you.
Yeah, it basically acts as like a removal spell, but it's hard because like its stats are kind of middling and not exciting. And, you know, the exciting tappers, like, there are exciting – there's literally an exciting tapper in this format. It's – so we'll talk about that, but I kind of agree with your assessment, so – let's go into blue. So I think our blues are different on every single spot.
True. We do have two of the same cards, but they're just on different numbers.
So I have Blinding Drone at number one. This is the 1/3. You can pay a colorless and tap it to tap down a creature. It's 1/3 for blue and one. I actually just, like, I don't even have a problem playing this card in, like, my blue-red decks. I don't think it's hard to get the colorless into your deck. I think the 1/3 body is, like, good. There's tons of grizzly bears in the set. I think this card is great. I think it's the best blue common by a lot.
Yeah, and I can see that argument. I think I need to draft the set a little bit more to get a feeling for how easy it is to get waste mana. Because there's sometimes when I'm drafting and I just feel like I cannot get any colorless mana at all. And I'm worried that the cards that I have that have colorless activated abilities or colorless in their casting.
I've never had that problem. I think that's why I have this so high. It's like, it feels like I can just get it.
Yeah. I mean, if you always have, I think, 4 to 5 colorless mana producing abilities, then Blinding Drone it's pretty easy to say it's the best blue common. When you don't have...
What would you say if you could only get two? Where would you rank this?
It's pretty middling for me. I mean,
really?
Yeah, it's a 1/3 for 2. So, I mean,
right,
I'll play it.
Let's say that, like, 20% of the time it's, like, the best common in your deck. Which is pretty easy to say, right? Mm-hmm. Like, because if you have... I guess that would be 3 lands, right? That would be... 3 lands would be... Well, I can't do math right now. So 3 lands, you have – there's a program that runs this. So I think at 3 lands, you have like a 22% chance of having one in any given game, right? Mm-hmm. Something in there. My math is probably way off. But, like, let's just round it out. Like, 2 to 3 lands, you have a 20% chance of this literally being one of the best commons in your deck. And the other times, it's a 1-3 for 2, which, like, I'm not opposed to playing. It's not great, but, like, 20% of the time, it's the best, like, one of, if not the, like, tappers have been the best commons many times throughout Magic history.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, absolutely. It's just the fact that if you don't get it turned on, it's obviously just kind of a very weak creature.
So how hard is it to prioritize that when you pick a blind? Like, let's say that we open a pack and, like, Blinding Drone is in the pack, and you think that Blinding Drone is as good as I think it is. How hard is it for you to prioritize getting 3 sources or 4 sources if that's what you want to do?
I don't think it's that hard if you have an eye towards it early on in the draft, right? If you think to yourself, okay, I got a pack and there is a card that I would usually be okay putting in my deck, but there is a Holdout Settlement or even a Waste in the pack. So you make an active decision to take the colorless source. Now, the problem is if the reverse is true, where you don't have any Blinding Drones or you don't have any Prophet of Distortions, and so you're not actively taking colorless cards, and then, you know, you get, say, Pat in pack 2, and you're already blue, and you get a Blinding Drone pack 2 fourth pick. Do you take Blinding Drone? Like, are you really sure you're going to still have a way to activate that card? You know, you're kind of gambling on getting those lands for the rest of the pack. Now, obviously, the earlier you take Blinding Drone, the more you can sculpt your draft around taking colorless cards or colorless producing lands and mana sources to be able to activate that card. So that's just kind of why I'm at where I am. I do agree. I think if you have... I'm pretty sure if you have at least 5 colorless sources, it's easily going to be far and away one of the best, if not easily the best blue common. It's just an issue of if you don't have the colorless sources, how actively good is it? You know, and like we said, 1-3 for 2, you'll play it. It's a Lumengrin Warden, but it's not like, oh yeah, this is, you know, there's a lot of things it just doesn't block very well. A lot of things it does block well, a lot of things it just doesn't block. And it's certainly much worse versus any sort of support deck, right? You're like, okay, they have a 2-1, I'm holding it off, now it's a 3-2, now I can't block it. So.
Sure. Let's move on to your number one. You have Sweep Away.
Yep. For all the reasons that I just talked about, consistency issues with Blinding Drone, I mean, I think I even had a draft deck where I had 6 colorless sources, if I remember correctly. Maybe it was 3 lands. Maybe what I was counting was 3 lands and 3 Scion Summoners in my deck. And there was just games where, like, the Blinding Drone just sat there. But Sweep Away, every time I had it, was exactly what I wanted it to do. It just completely resets the tempo on a card. It resets counters. It effectively, not only does it kill an Awaken land in the late game, it also gives them the top pick of a land. So I like Sweep Away a lot. I think it's a pretty good blue card. And yeah, pretty much every time you draw it, you're going to be pretty happy to have it, I think.
Yeah, I actually have Sweep Away, I believe I have it at number 2, right? Yeah, I have it at number 2. So I'm pretty close to you on it. A lot of people don't like it. I think it's great, and I'm not sure where the disdain comes from, in all honesty.
It may be because it's not the greatest card when you are actively attacking, but, I mean, you have the option to, it's kind of like an Immolating Glare that has this option to remove a blocker and let you attack with a bunch of creatures, so.
Sure. That's my thought. My thought is that it's like, it almost feels like the blue Immolating Glare.
Yeah, I mean, not quite that good, but very close, I think.
Yeah. So I'm with you. I on Twitter, via other podcasts, I've heard disdain for it, and I just haven't had any problems with it. I think that your evaluation of, like, there's tons of things that get counters, and, like, things just attack in this format a lot.
Yeah.
And instance V time ebb is really good.
Yeah, I mean, I just the thought of putting a land, you know, an awakened land on top of my opponent's deck is just, I mean, far and away, I love that feeling. It's like, hey, I killed your biggest creature, and you're top decking a land next turn. Like, that's pretty awesome.
Sure. Next up, we have for you. You have it at number two. I have it at number three. Jawar, Isle Avenger.
Yeah, this I think is a lot lower than, like, the difference in power level, I think, between Sweep Away and Draw Wild Avenger is quite a bit. And it's just, it's a blue flyer, right? I mean, sometimes you will get the surge off, and obviously decks that are better able to get the surge, it'll be much more powerful. But quite often I find myself just casting this for five. And a 3-3 flyer for five is, it's fine. It's, you know, it's a card you're happy to play. It's better than probably most of the creatures in your deck. It'll finish games off. When you do surge it, it's pretty good, though, so.
Yeah, I think this card is, like, way worse than I thought it was going to be. Like, by a lot, actually. Which makes me really sad, because I thought this card was going to be great. And it is only good in red-blue, I think. I guess it could be okay in, like, I don't really want to draft blue-white. I think red-blue is, like, kind of where it belongs. I don't really like it in blue-black. I'm sure it might actually be good in blue-green.
Yeah, I think you have a decent amount of cheap cards in blue-green.
So it could be good there. But yeah, way less impressed than I thought I would be with it. Which is why I have it as low as number three, whereas I probably would have had it at number one to start the set.
Yeah, I agree. I probably would have had it about Sweep Away when I first looked at the set. It seemed much more exciting to have a 3-3 flyer for three mana, so.
Sure. Well, let's go to the next card on your list. You have Blinding Drone.
Cultivator Drone, actually.
Or Cultivator Drone, sorry.
Yeah. So Cultivator Drone is great with Blinding Drone. I mean, it kind of acts like a Spawn Binder Mage because, again, you're tapping two creatures to tap something. But the fact that Cultivator Drone is a card that I think you can play in any blue deck is great. And I honestly, I may still just be underestimating the amount of waste mana you can get in decks. If you can get enough waste mana consistently, then Blinding Drone's probably quite a bit better than Jawar Avenger and Cultivator Drone. I'm just kind of being conservative here and just saying, look, Cultivator Drone is a blue card I'm happy to play in any deck, whether it is a colorless deck or even a non-real colorless deck. So,
okay. Let's move on to black. Obviously, we both have Oblivion Strike at number one. We've talked about this already. It's the best common in the set. Like, it's easily splashable, and it just kills anything for four mana.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, Oblivion Strike is very, I mean, just flat out, and it exiles it too. So, Oblivion Strike is quite good.
The next one I want to focus on yours, because I actually strongly disagree with you. I have not been impressed with Tarsnare.
Yeah, it's it's... The thing about Tarsnare is it's a card you'll always play, and the fact that it lets your creatures win combat I think is very important.
I don't think that you could – sorry, I don't mean to interrupt you. I don't think you could convince me to take a Tarsnare over a Vampire Envoy.
I think I would still the reason I would still take Tarsnare is that removal is still basically – always at a premium, I think. And the fact that Tarsnare lets you double it up to take down bigger creatures, I think is pretty good. One of the reasons a card like Reality Hemorrhage is not quite as good as Tarsnare is that if you want to double it up with a creature to take down a bigger creature, you always lose two cards out of the deal. Whereas with Tarsnare, you can often just lose just straight up the Tarsnare. And every single time I played with Tarsnare, it was better than I had originally anticipated when I did play with it. So it's a card I think I'm happy taking. Just obviously you have to kind of understand that it's not going to be a flat out, all right, this kills anything. It obviously has its limitations. And it's possible that Vampire Envoy is better than Tar Snare. It's just that I often find, like I said, that creatures you get quite a bit limited when you're taking them. So
for me, when I'm taking Tar Snare, I actually feel like I didn't get enough unnatural endurances or Oblivion Strikes in my deck. And it makes me sad. I think that you're right. I think that you'll always play Tar Snare, but I don't have it this high.
Fair enough.
Next up, we have Vampire Envoy at number 2 for me and 3 for you. We talked about this already. Like, that card is just way better than we thought it was.
Yep, absolutely. Like I said, it's one of those creatures that you look at and you think, this is just kind of a middling card, and then you play with it and you realize, okay, this card is very, very good.
Yeah, next up for me, I have Unnatural Endurance, the card that I just mentioned. I think this card is like everything I've ever wanted.
Yeah, it's definitely it's easily the best combat trick in the format. It generally lets your creature kill whatever creature they're in combat with, and they will almost always survive. The only reason they wouldn't survive is if something happened, like, say, in response to the Unnatural Endurance. But once the Unnatural Endurance resolves, your creature should be pretty much always living in combat.
Yeah.
So, the beautiful thing about Unnatural Endurance is, like, even if they have an opposing combat trick, your creature still lives. So right. It's not like they get a 2-for-1 out of you. They just get rid of your Unnatural Endurance.
Yep. Yeah, I've been really impressed with the card. It's I knew it would be good, and it's just been as good as I thought it would be.
Yeah.
Going into red, I'm pretty sure that we have I'm pretty sure we have the exact same 3.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah. Number 1, Boulder Salvo. Man, this card was like way better than I thought it would be.
Yeah, I mean, like, Boulder Salvo is very, very, very powerful. I mean, 2 mana, deal 4 damage to a creature. You know, not quite Flame Slash levels, but for the cards we have in these limited sets, very, very strong.
Yeah, and, like, 5 mana to do it is still something that I would pay for.
Yeah, I mean, at that point, it's similar to Stone Fury from Battle for Zendikar. Not quite as good, but usually good enough.
Yeah.
I apologize.
We're doing this in the morning. The next one we both have is Zada's Commando. And we talked about this one too. It's just like, it's a common. I can't believe this is a common.
Yeah, it does not feel like a common to me.
Yeah, I personally like it best in red-green. Although, first of all, because you get more allies in that deck. And the next deck that I like it is in red-blue.
Yeah, I like it a lot in red-white, too.
Sure.
I think it's pretty good in the red-white deck, so.
Yeah, shoulder-to-shoulder, the Raptor, like, definitely fits into that deck, too.
Yeah, and red-white has a ton of allies, so.
Yes, it does, yep. And then at number 3 in red, we will have Reality Hemorrhage.
Yeah, I mean, again, like I said, just a solid, you know, does 2 damage. Not the most exciting removal spell, but it is removal, so you're going to play it and you're going to take it fairly high. Not obviously like slam dunk first pick, so.
No, I think that this is one of those cards that I'm not happy to pick first pick, but I'm not unhappy to pick second pick. It's like right there. And I am happy to pick third pick. Like, kind of like, kind of this curve. I think that it's best in red-blue, but I'm not unhappy to play it in basically any red deck. Coming in next, we have green, and I think our green are different by 2 cards. Coming in at number 1, we both have Saddleback Lagak, though.
Yeah, this card has really impressed me with how powerful it is. Like I said, when the set first came out, I was not that impressed with it. Again, back to the fact that it's a 3/1 vanilla creature, but like you said, kind of shades of a really bad Bloodbraid elf. It effectively is like a 4-mana, you know, gives you a card effectively, right? Because if you think lead by example, the sorcery, the one in a green support 2, if you think that's worth a card, then Saddleback Lilgak is effectively giving you a card,
right,
as well as a 3-power creature for 4-mana.
Right. I've just been so impressed. Like, I did not think that I would ever have this card as high as I have it.
Yeah, it just doesn't seem, it's still in my head, it doesn't seem that great, because I'm like, it has one toughness, like, anything blocks it and trades with it. But the fact that you're going to play it, and usually when you play it, your creatures get to attack past your opponent's creatures without them having very good blocks, so.
Next up, we have, for me, at number 2, I have Scion Summoner. This card has gone up a lot because of Saddleback Lilgak. I also think that it can ramp you into, like, your 5-drop, the Path Warden, which is another great green common. Yeah, I've just been impressed with it. I think that's what you have at number 3, right?
Yeah, I have it at number 3. Honestly, every single time I've played it, it's kind of disappointed for me.
Oh, really?
It's been disappointing for me. Yeah, it's just... The problem is it's a 2/2 vanilla creature, right? Like, I mean, you know, at any point, it's pretty easy to outclass a 2/2, especially the later the game goes. With that being said, it's still a pretty decent card. It gives you, you know, 2 bodies. It's just that the bodies, unlike Eldrazi Skyspawner, you don't get an evasive creature out of it. So, yeah, it's fine. It's a decent green card. If I get past Scion Summoners, I'm going to think to myself, green's probably open. But just, like I said, every time I played it, I've just kind of been like, I have this 2/2 creature. It's just not doing that much for me. So, but yeah, the fact that it has nice synergy with Saddleback, because it's that natural curve of, okay, I don't have any creatures, but then I played a Scion Summoner, then I played a Saddleback Lilgak, and still was able to support on 2 creatures is pretty good as well.
Yep. And then coming in at number 2 for you, instead of number 3, and this is the one that I had at 4, is T'Jiru Pathwarden.
Yeah, I think this is kind of the right mix of stats and costs for a big green creature. To 5/4 for 5, has Vigilance and Trample. The Vigilance, I think, is really good, too. Because usually what happens is you play a big green creature and you want to be able to block with it the turn you play it, and then you want to start attacking with it, but then that also opens the window for your opponent to start attacking you back with their smaller creatures. Pathwarden just says, nope, I'm just going to keep beating down, and you are still going to have to figure out a way to get around me.
Yeah, I think the card is just great. It surpasses the big dumb green creature. Like, the big dumb green creature is like this stupid 6-drop 6/7 worm, right? But this is like more elegant than that, with the vigilance that does all the things you just talked about.
Yep, and yeah, like I said, it's kind of right on that sweet spot on the curve for being a big green creature. I think 6 is always just like slightly too expensive, right? Like, you'll play a 6-drop big dumb green creature in your deck. I mean, I will anyways. But it's never going to be that exciting. And usually a lot of times what can happen is it can come out slightly too late, or you play it and then it gets like removed and you're really far behind at that point. This is kind of, like I said, right at that sweet spot of being 5 mana. So being 5, I think, is quite a bit less than 6. Which means that even if they have a way to get rid of it, like a bounce spell or a removal spell, you're not quite as far behind. So.
Yep. I completely agree. So we did want to, I want to touch on 2 more things and then we can wrap this up. So first of all, there's only 5 colorless commons. And I think that the only one really worth talking about is Hedron Crawler. That card is great. Drew got one last pick in a draft that should not go that late.
Yeah, Hedron Crawler is very, very, very good. The ability to go from 2 to 4 mana is very powerful and limited. Definitely be taking Hedron Collar is pretty high. I don't know where I would rate them. I mean, definitely much worse, I think, than cards like Oblivion Strike, Isolation Zone, Sweep Away, Boulder Salvo, all those cards I would take over it. I don't know if I would take it over a Saddleback Lickak. I don't know.
I wouldn't.
We know Spencer wouldn't. We know Spencer loves his Saddlebacks. Lagak. Is that a lizard? Is that what that is?
It's a lizard.
Is that an actual lizard? Now I'm curious. Hold on.
It is. It is a lizard creature. Creature lizard.
No, I mean, like, is there, like, an actual... Is Lagak, like, a... Is that just...
Oh, is that a kind of lizard? I don't know.
Yeah. I think it's a mythical creature, because I don't see anything...
This is literally the thing that Obi-Wan Kenobi rode to fight General Grievous, right? Like, what else would you want in your life? The other thing that I want to talk about is how good I have found Holdout Settlement to be. I actually think that card is just great.
Yeah, it's definitely much better than what's the name of the one that's like the unknown? Is it Unknown Shores?
Unknown Shores is actually in this set.
Okay, that's the one that you tap an extra mana to generate a colored mana, right?
Correct.
I like Holdout Settlement a lot more because. It still lets you play whatever card you're casting on curve.
Right.
Right. You can play a 5-mana spell on turn 5, as opposed to Unknown Shores, you have to play your 5-mana spell on turn 6, if it's your splash card or whatever.
Yeah, a good way to think about this is like Strider Harness. If you play a Strider Harness and you wait to play your creature until you can equip it, you actually didn't gain anything from it. It's attacking on the same turn that it would have attacked anyway. And the same thing is true of Unknown Shores. Like, the card, you didn't gain anything. You actually just lost. Just lost tempo by playing Unknown Shores. I still think Unknown Shores is better in this set than it was in Innistrad, but, Holdout Sediment is great, so.
Yeah, that's the best common colorless land pretty easily, so.
All right, let's wrap this up with what's the pick. I think we have one. So what's the pick? You can tweet a picture of your hashtag what's the pick of a booster pack, and we'll talk about it. So we have pack one, pick one at a GP top 8. And the question – there's no rare in this pack. Oh, is there? No, there's no rare. Did Corehaven take the place of a rare? 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Oh, no. Overwhelming Denial is the rare. Okay. I'm not taking Overwhelming Denial. We have Warden of Geometries, Slaughter Drone, Reality Hemorrhage, Expedition Raptor, Negate, Spark Mage's Gambit, McKindy Arianaut. I don't know the name of the 6-mana 6/5 worm, but I'm not taking it, so it doesn't matter. Kozilek's Translator. Iona's Blessing, Corehaven. So there's an expedition. So you taking that? GP top 8, man.
Oh, GP top 8? Not in a GP top 8. in an 8-man, you know, Friday Night Magic Trap? Yeah, I'm taking the expedition.
Ruling Waters. This is the 7-mana sorcery. You return up to 2 creatures to your opponent's hand, and then target player draws 2 cards. And then we also have Overwhelming Denial and I can't read this. I believe it's Eldrazi. Oh no, it's Immobilizer Eldrazi, so it's the 2-mana 2/1 Devoid. So for me it's between, man, this pack sucks.
is this pack one, pick one?
Yeah. I would either take Reality Hemorrhage or the 7 drop.
What's the name of the card? I would take the blue 7 drop.
The Rolling Waters.
Yeah, Rolling Waters. Pretty easily. That seems like a pretty easy pick for me.
I have yet to play with Rolling Waters. I believe that it's sweet, but I have yet to play with it.
Yeah, that's an easy Rolling Waters for me.
You think so? You think it's easier? Because I don't hate taking Reality Hemorrhage here.
Yeah.
I'd probably take the Rolling Waters. I'd want to play with it.
I mean, it's it's a pretty powerful effect for what it does. So sure.
Yeah, I can get on board. I'm in. All right. Well, that's it. Where can people find you, man?
I'm on Facebook at Andrew Walden, and then I'm on Twitter at MTGDrew.
You can find me at Spencer13H on Twitter. You can find the show at LTOMTG. You can find us on ConstructedCriticism.com, YouTube, on the Constructed Criticism page, MTGCast.com, and OasisGamesSLC.com. Don't forget that you can also find me on Facebook at Spencer Stephen Howland, and you can join the Constructed Criticism Facebook group to be talking about all the things that love that we love about Magic. So, Drew, I would guess that you would give a shout out to the director of Deadpool, but you haven't seen it.
I have not seen Deadpool yet. No, unfortunately. My shout out this week actually goes to Lee Fisher, the level 2 judge in Utah.
He's actually from Idaho.
Oh, from Idaho. I did not know that. Well, he judges here a lot. So.
Yeah, exactly. He's a man.
I give a shout out to him because I actually talked with him a bit at a PPTQ this Sunday. Even though I wasn't playing with it, I was there hanging out with some friends and stuff. Actually talked to him about a couple different various rules questions that he was pretty excited about. He was actually super excited because he asked Travis and I a rules question. And he was surprised both of us got the rules question correct when he's like, out of every other person I've asked, including judges, they've gotten it wrong.
Oh, go you.
So, yeah. So Lee's a really nice guy. And especially a shout out if he's driving to Idaho to judge our events. So,
yeah. Lee is just a nice guy. He's a great guy. I have a shout out to Saddleback Lagak. I have a shout out to green cards in general. Man, I miss drafting green sometimes.
Oh man, it's funny because I'm like, do I really want to draft green? And then I like open a Nissa's Judgment and I'm like, I guess I'm drafting green.
But it's funny because like blue white is terrible and green is just great. I am not unhappy to draft green anymore. And it's a good feeling. It's a good feeling to feel that way.
Yeah, I mean, green is definitely much better than it was with triple battle. So that's good at least.
Yeah. And then shout out to you, Drew. It was fun doing this. I'm sorry. I feel bad. It's all my fault. Just been busy.
Nope, I understand. Super Bowl, the holiday, you know, whatever. I understand. So not a big
hashtag
deal.
Hashtag marriage.
hashtag marriage. Hashtag what I don't know, Super Bowl, hashtag Super Bowl.
Did you watch the Super Bowl?
I did, actually.
I'm surprised.
You're surprised? It's like it's basically like an American event at this point, right? Like, I mean, it's probably the one sporting event I've consistently seen since forever. Yeah, you know, I'll usually catch like
it's
sporting events like every other year or whatever. Like there was one year I watched like March Madness, you know, was following March Madness the whole time. Then another year I think I watched the finals, the NBA finals. But yeah, I mean the Super Bowl is basically just an event at this point. So
do you think that people in other countries, like, do you think that they think of the Olympics the way we think of the Super Bowl? Or like The World Cup is like gaining huge amounts in the U.S. That's probably something that other countries like.
Yeah, I was gonna say it's not the Olympics you should compare the Super Bowl to. It's soccer or football for them. So, it's huge for them, right? Like they go nuts over watching, but the World Cup's every 4 years. I don't know of anything outside of the World Cup. I don't know if there's some annual tournament that the world tunes in to watch and they all
the World Cup, and then when Real Salt Lake is in the playoffs is like the only soccer I watch.
Yeah, I don't even watch. I hope nobody gets angry at me, but I don't even really watch the World Cup. It's just, I hate to say it, but soccer is just boring to me. I mean, it's just
no one's hitting each other.
It's not even that. It's just like it's like, all right, the ball's down at the end. All right, now it's back to the other end. All right, you know what I mean? Like the ball just kind of goes back and forth. There's
yeah,
no scores. There's
I do.
No, nothing
I
like
do.
That. Like I can watch a basketball or a football or even a hockey game, right? And like
hockey is actually underrated.
I think hockey. I've been to a couple of live sporting events. I've been to a basketball game. I've been to a hockey game. I've been to baseball games, and hockey is actually, I think, the most exciting sport for live events that I've seen so far, because it's fast paced. There's never any breaks, right? Like, they basically never stop. They're like, okay, we're doing a lineup switch. All right, they don't even stop the clock, right? They just whoop, they swap around three or four guys or however many guys are swapping, and they just keep playing the game. It's really fast because they're skating around, they're hitting each other. There's enough goals going on, right? Unlike soccer, where it's like the game ended 0-0, like it was a tie or whatever. But in hockey, you know, usually you have, I think, scores range between like 3-7 or whatever. So there's enough goals going on that it's exciting, it's fast paced, it never stops, they're hitting each other. So I actually think hockey is one of the like most exciting sports to see live as opposed to the other sports. And it's not the most popular American sport. So
It used to be way more popular, but I think basketball has really picked up in popularity.
Basketball is still kind of exciting to watch, too. But basketball, I still kind of feel like sometimes there's lulls going on in basketball. You know, there's sometimes some slow drives, or there's a timeout, or, you know, free throws are being shot. So there's still kind of some of those lulls going on in the game. Hockey is just constant, nonstop. Like, they just don't stop going. So.
Sure. Well, I hope you get to see Deadpool this week.
I'm going to try and make time maybe to see it this weekend.
And I hope everybody enjoyed this week's episode, and we'll see y'all in a few weeks.
Yep, see you guys in a couple weeks.